I turn to Senator Cantwell for her opening comments.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and welcome to the nominee and to his family for being here today. This is an important hearing, and these issues are very important for the entire nation. The Deputy Assistant Secretary in supervising and administrating the department performs important functions of the Secretary in the Secretary's absence. In virtually all matters, the Deputy has the full authority of the Secretary, and that is why it's critical today to have a full review of the nominee and pass important positions that he will be responsible for. I have to say at the outset that I have concerns about Mr. Bernhardt's nomination. Certainly, he's no stranger to the Department of Interior, and he's no stranger to our committee. He's held a number of senior political positions in the department during the Bush administration, including the department's solicitor beginning in 2006. And since leaving the department in 2009, Mr. Bernhardt has returned from a very successful private sector practice. He has represented a wide range of clients, including oil and gas companies, mining companies, water supply interests in California, just to name a few. And he has previously been tasked with helping to oversee these same companies while at the Department of Interior. Mr. Bernhardt is now seeking to come back through this revolving door and be part of regulating the same and overseeing the same issues that he was lobbying for in the private sector. I'm not suggesting that working for the private sector just disqualifies someone from the public sector, but I'm reminded that of the various nominees before this committee and the various issues that my colleagues have brought up during the Obama administration. I don't think they are going to be the ones we're bringing up today. For example, people on the committee were rejected nominees during the Obama administration for simply having worked for a national environmental group, having served on the board of environmental group, and in one case, simply being a vegetarian. Those objections for disqualifying the nominee were patently absurd, and they remain so today. But because of the extensive background Mr. Bernhardt has had in the private sector, these issues of conflict of interest or appearance of conflict of interest will be the subject of my questions today. His ethics agreements say he will not participate in particular matters involving specific parties in which his firm is a party or representative, and I'll have questions for him on that. But these ethic rules only require him to recuse himself for 1 year or 2 years if he adheres to the Trump administration pledge. Mr. Bernhardt has had considerable experience working with the department from his service during the Bush administration as counselor to the secretary, Director of Congressional and Legislative Affairs, Deputy Chief of Staff, Deputy Solicitor, and Solicitor. And from that practice and from his background for energy, mining, and water clients, has a great deal of experience. But his work for those clients also poses a problem. It creates at least an inherent appearance of conflict, and today we're going to talk about some of that. Why is this important? Well, in the Reagan and Bush administrations, James Watt and Gail Norton, who was also investigated for giving potential treatment to Shell and later taking a job with Shell, and Stephen Griles, who was investigated for conflict of interest and went to prison for obstructing a Senate investigation, all came to the Department of Interior after representing energy and natural resource clients. So, in their confirmation hearing, they came before the committee and assured us that they would successfully switch sides and disassociate themselves from these former clients. But their outlook, their frame of reference, their policies they pursued at the same time had challenges. So, these were the policies aimed at monetizing the values of American natural resources and public lands for the benefits of corporations and the expense of taxpayers. So, these are important issues that we want to address today. It took fewer than 100 days of the Trump administration for the new secretary to start rolling back important land conservation measures. So, to simply say to us, don't worry today, is not going to be the issue. Mr. Bernhardt's nomination raises further questions that his prior service at Interior came at a time when the agency faced legal scrutiny over their ethics failings. He was the department's top legal officer. At the time, the department's inspector general described it as, quote, having a culture of ethical failure, end quote. In September 2006, just before the Senate confirmed Mr. Bernhardt as the solicitor, but after he had been serving 5 years in a senior position, including Deputy Secretary and Inspector General, including as Deputy Secretary. The Inspector General testified before the House Committee, quote, simply stated, short of a crime, anything goes at the highest level of the Department of Interior. Ethic failures on the part of senior department officials taking the form of appearances of impropriety, favoritism, and bias have been routinely dismissed with a promise of won't do it again, end quote. So, both Secretary Norton and Deputy Secretary Griles were investigated for those conflict of interest, and as I said, Deputy Secretary Griles was ultimately convicted and went to prison for obstructing the Senate Indian Affairs Committee investigation of the Jack Abramoff scandal. Julie McDonald, an assistant secretary in the department, was forced to resign. She was found to have been given internal agency documents to industry lobbyists that pressured agency scientists to withhold information and improperly modify scientific data to further her agenda against the Endangered Species Act. Drug use, misconduct between agency staff, rampant conflicts, and prevalent of mineral management services. Not saying that all of this happened during his watch, but certainly these were the things that the agency went after. So, have questions about tackling those issues. The lack of enforcement and oversight attitudes ultimately led to the complete restructuring of the agency. Mr. Bernhardt was a senior political leadership in the position during many of these events, and he counseled the secretary and served as a deputy chief of staff during this time. So given this role, I hope he'll be able to shed light on the extent of some of these, his role in some of these matters and what further reforms we need, and specifically the issue of conflict of interest will be something that I plan to ask about, Madam Chair, during the Q&A, because Mr. Bernhardt has represented Cadiz, a company which is seeking to pump groundwater near the Mojave National Preserve in Southern California to sell it elsewhere. His law firm has a unique compensation arrangement, and I find it interesting that upon taking office, the Trump administration quickly reversed the previous administration's opposition to this project. So we want to understand Mr. Bernhardt's clients, his partners, and what their financial benefits are from this project. We do know that the LA Business Journal reported earlier this month that Cadiz was able to raise $255 million in private equity investment premised on the Trump administration approval. So again, these issues of clients and past issues at the agency will be the subject of many of our questions. I do have a longer statement that I'm going to enter into the record about other issues of concern that we just don't have time at this point to go over, but clearly his work on behalf of the Westlands Irrigation District, in addition, serving as the lead attorney for the state of Alaska's lawsuit challenging the Department of Interior's management of the Arctic Wildlife Refuge, and litigation and lobbying on behalf of Taylor Energy, which operates a well that has been leaking into the Gulf of Mexico since 2004. So I'm very interested to have the explanation on this previous tenure at Interior and avoidance of conflict of interest on many of these issues that I've just raised. I think the Department of Interior should be the guardian of public interest when it comes to stewardship of our public lands and our natural resources. So I look forward to hearing the nominee talk about those issues and being able to ask questions. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Flick. Senator Cantwell.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and sorry I had to leave to run to vote, and thank you for my colleagues letting me weigh in here. I wanted to ask you, I mentioned in my statement about previous times that you were at the Department of Interior and some of the challenges that the agency faced, particularly Deputy Secretary Griles and his conviction for obstructing the Senate Indian Affairs Committee, and Julie McDonald for basically internal documents that were pressuring agency scientists to withhold information improperly. I'm assuming you agree with the decision for both of those individuals to be dismissed and prosecuted on those issues.
To be prosecuted?
I think she was both, they were found guilty and for obstructing. I don't know where it went after that. Do you agree with their firings? How about that?
Sure.
Okay. And what do you think was wrong with what they were doing at the agency?
Well, if you've looked at, and I assume you have reviewed the Inspector General reports.
Yes.
So if you look at those reports, what you'll see is that there's two issues. One is the conduct of an employee. But there were also very significant structural issues of how lawyers were advising clients and whether that information was moving through the decision-making process. So what I personally did is I ensured that we put in new legal review processes so that we could always manage to have the clients talking to lawyers in a way that would allow them to freely communicate their views and move their views up the chain so that things were modified.
I guess I'm trying to get a reading on how egregious you think it was that Julie McDonald tried to pressure the scientists to withhold information or modify scientific data to further the agenda. How egregious do you
it was very serious. There's two very serious problems. One is the manner in which Julie went about a discussion with folks, and that was clearly abrasive. When you read the report, you see that. The other fundamental problem was that legal questions and legal information that was provided to the Fish and Wildlife Service as part of the listing packages was not being incorporated in the department, and it was a result of that. That if you look at that report, you'll see that I put a surname legal review process in place that ensured that legal conflicts, would rise to me if necessary to resolve. And if I couldn't resolve an issue with Julie, I would go to the deputy secretary. So I personally put in place a means to correct, not only correct, but proactively eliminate the problem of a disconnect between what Julie McDonald wanted to do and what the lawyers wanted to do. And when it came to me, it was either resolved my way or I went to the deputy secretary and I said, we need to fix it. In addition, once these issues came out through Earl Devaney, I went to the deputy secretary and I said the following.
Okay.
I said,
I have a lot of questions.
I must at least be able to complete my sentence. I said, Deputy Secretary, we need to revise and evaluate these decisions. And she requested that the Fish and Wildlife Service begin a review process of all decisions so that none of them were tainted.
You can extend your remarks as long as you want on this. It was just a simple question to get this issue registered to you as how egregious you thought these actions were and how aggressive you might be in the future. That wasn't pushing you on what you did to rectify that, although I could, that's a different line of questioning. I have questions about both Cadiz and Westland.
Sure.
And as you can see, my colleagues are asking these questions because they don't want the rules. We don't want to have a culture at Interior where people decide to prosecute these things on their own. Have you received any compensation for your work, including additional shares of stocks on the Cadiz question and compensation that would reflect, since you've exited the firm?
Well, I would exit the firm if I were to be confirmed. And if I did, my ethics agreement is clear that I would not have any continuing interest in the firm, and therefore I would have no interest in anything of value that the firm might have.
Including shares of stock or?
I would have no interest in any shares or theoretical potential for shares, none.
Do you believe that you or your firm worked on behalf of Cadiz in any way to influence the Trump administration's decision to reverse the BLM decision, either directly or indirectly?
Well, I know that I had no involvement with the Trump administration. I had either directly or indirectly. I had no involvement on the Cadiz matter with the transition, none with the department, none with the Hill during that period of time.
Do you believe that your works firm, did you discuss the project with anybody as part of the Trump transition team? Or any member of Congress?
Absolutely. During that period of time? Absolutely
yes.
not.
Okay. What about in the last 6 months in general?
I have to do
prior
that.
prior to the transition team?
Absolutely not.
Okay. As a lawyer, do you believe the transitions team's non-disclosure agreement authorizes the withholding of information from Congress or is it legally enforceable under the Whistleblower Protection Act?
Well, I hate to give you a lawyer's answer to a legal question in a hearing, but I think the first question would be whether or not the Whistleblower Act would even apply to the transition, because it's my understanding that Trump for America is a nonprofit entity, and so I'm not sure that the legal rubric that falls for government would even apply to that. I just don't simply know the answer to that question.
I see I'm over my time. We'll come back on a second
Thank
round,
you.
Madam Chair. Thank you. Our last commentation was on this issue of the transition team. So regardless of whether the Whistleblower Enhancement Act applies to the transition team, do you believe the transition team's non-disclosure agreement authorizes the withholding of information from Congress?
Well, I certainly believe that I've signed a non-disclosure agreement, and to the extent that that disclosure agreement exists, I have to ensure that I've done everything I can to comply with it.
So do you think it's a good policy that the president's transition team actually requires the transition team to withhold information from Congress? Do you think that's a good idea?
I don't know if they've made that assertion or not.
Do you think it's a good idea? Do you think that idea in general is to withhold information because of the transition team from Congress?
At the end of the day, I felt that it was acceptable for me to sign a non-disclosure agreement, and I did, and I'm obviously bound by that agreement.
Okay, I'll take that as on its face what you've said. Your firm has, I know, has an agreement on this Cadiz issue in the value of stock. And so has your firm benefited recently from the announced Trump policy on Cadiz, or has it benefited to date in the context of this, you know, since the time of the policy?
In terms of?
Increased payment. Benefited financially.
Not that I'm aware of.
Okay. Was the compensation reflected in any, you had a personal financial disclosure statement that is about stock and equity, and is there any updated financial disclosure on that we haven't seen since?
Well, I think the way the process worked is I had to submit a letter to you, I believe, maybe even yesterday or Tuesday, that it contained any updates as they related to my interest, and that has been submitted to you. And obviously, it does not include anything related to the Cadiz matter or anything like that. I simply have no interest in those items.
Okay, so nothing reflects in that statement any kind of payment or increase in payment through the firm to you prior to you, prior to this filing?
Well, it would, I believe the letter includes what would be my draws for 1 or maybe 2 months as it related to the, whatever the time horizon of the letter is.
On the issues of both Westland and Cadiz, I think what you have testified to is that you would adhere to whatever recusals are required, 1 year period, and then whatever the administration, so maybe a 2 year. Don't you think that the general public would wonder, have concerns about a recusal period for a longer period of time on something where the investment and performance of your firm will be resulting in decisions on Cadiz in the future?
Well, I've signed exactly the same agreements that folks that were reported out of the committee with your support included, And on top of that, whatever my firm's interest may or may not be, the minute I walk out of that firm, I have no interest in their interest. And that is the way the law operates. That's the way the law is set up. And that is the way I will follow the law.
You don't find it a conflict that you have worked for this firm and you've been part of the Department of Interior. You could go back to this firm. Clearly, during the transition period, this firm's payment as it relates to stock value has gone up just because of the decisions of the administration. So, yes, I have a question about whether you had any discussions with anybody during that time period to influence the decision by the administration. You've said that you haven't. And I personally think that Westlands and Cadiz represent such large public policy issues with financial interests that it would be better if you recused yourself for the entire time that you were at the department, not just 1 or 2 years. Do you have a comment about that idea?
Well, I appreciate that you have that perspective. And I can sit here and walk through numerous entities that you've supported that you didn't ask that of. And the reality is I will follow all of the recusals I have. And on top of that, if I get a whiff of something coming my way that involves a client or a former client or my firm, I'm going to make that item run straight to the ethics office. And when it gets there, they'll make whatever decisions they're going to make, and that will be it for me.
I would ask you to think about a longer term than 1 to 2 years. Thank you, Madam
Chair. Let's turn to